Good evening and welcome to this Tenebrae service on Good Friday. My name is Matt O'Reilly. I'm one of the pastors here at Hope Hole United Methodist Church. If you're worshiping with us through Facebook or on YouTube, we welcome you. Thank you for being a part of this special evening of Christian worship. A Tenebrae service is a traditional service often held on Good Friday. Tenebrae refers to shadows or darkness, and the service is characterized by increasing darkness as the candles are extinguished during the reading of Christ's passion. So the closer the narrative moves to the death of Christ, the darker the room gets as the candles are extinguished. Won't you take a moment and prepare your hearts as we begin our time of worship? And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and we loved darkness rather than light. God is light, in whom there is no darkness at all. For God sent the Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Everyone who does evil hates the light and does not come to the light. But all who do what is true come to the light. Come, let us worship in spirit and in truth. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Most gracious God, look with mercy upon your family gathered here, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, given into sinful hands and suffered death upon the cross. Strengthen our faith and forgive our betrayals as we enter the way of his passion. Through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen. Hear now the passion of our Lord. Now Peter was warming himself in the courtyard when a small slave girl entered. She confronted Peter and said, "You also were with this Jesus the Nazarene." Peter quickly gave a denial, "I do not know what you are talking about." He replied these words and went outside into the gateway. Meanwhile, the cock crowed. The slave girl followed Peter out and said to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." Again, Peter denied knowing Jesus. After a little while, the bystanders said directly to Peter, "Surely you are one of them, for you speak with a Galilean accent." Then Peter began to swear with an oath, "I do not know this person of whom you are speaking." But the cock interrupted him as it crowed for the second time. Immediately, Peter remembered how Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." He went out and wept bitterly. When morning arrived, all of the chief priests, along with the other Roman collaborators, bound Jesus and delivered him over to Pontius Pilate, the imperial Roman governor. When Judas saw what was happening, he knew that Jesus was doomed, and he repented. He returned the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and confessed, "I have sinned in betraying innocent blood." "What is that to us?" they responded. "That is your affair." Judas threw down the 30 pieces of silver in the temple. Then he went out and hanged himself. Picking up the silver pieces, the chief priest said, "It is unlawful to put this silver into the treasury, for it is blood money." Whereupon they used the money to buy the potter's field for the burial of strangers. Therefore, that field is known to us this day as the field of blood. Jesus stood before the Roman governor as the accusers made their charge. "We found this man perverting our nation," they said. "He was forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor and proclaiming himself anointed king." The governor asked, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "You say so." The chief priests were accusing him of many things. Therefore, Pilate again spoke to Jesus. "Have you no answer to give?" he asked. "Look at how many accusations they are making." Jesus astonished Pilate by remaining silent. At that festival, the governor used to release a prisoner, and some were urging Pilate to do so at this time. Now, there was a notable rebel in prison with those who had committed murder during the insurrection. His name was Jesus Barabbas. Therefore, the chief priests arranged a demonstration to demand Barabbas. Pilate asked them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus the Anointed One?" The demonstrators shouted, "Barabbas!" Pilate responded, "What shall I do then with Jesus the Anointed One?" The crowd shouted, "Crucify him." Pilate continued, "Are you certain of his guilt?" The crowd took up the chant, "Crucify him, crucify him." Again Pilate spoke, "Shall I crucify your king?" "We have no king but Caesar," cried the demonstrators. Then Pilate agreed to release Jesus Barabbas. But Jesus the Anointed One, he handed over to his soldiers for scourging and crucifixion. The soldiers led Jesus away within the governor's palace. There they assembled the whole battalion. They clothed Jesus in royal purple. They set a crown of thorns upon his head and shoved a reed between his fingers for a scepter. They began to mock him by kneeling before him and proclaiming, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They also spat upon him and smote him on the head with a stick. Then, after mocking him, they took away the purple, returned his own clothes, and brought him out to crucify him. On the road, they met an African of Cyrene named Simon, coming in from the countryside. Him they compelled to carry the cross. They brought Jesus to a place called Golgotha, which means skull. There they crucified him. They offered him wine mingled with myrrh, but he refused it. His garments they divided among themselves, casting lots for them. Over his head they inscribed the charge against him, "The King of the Jews." Also there were two insurrectionists crucified with him, one to his right and one to his left. Those who passed by were shaking their heads in derision and saying, "So you would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Save yourself, come down from the cross." Likewise, the priestly collaborators mocked him as they said to one another, "He saved others, himself he cannot save. Let the Anointed One, the King of Israel, come down from the cross that we may see and believe." Even the two crucified with him reviled him. Now from midday there was darkness over the whole land until 3 p.m. At that hour Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," words that mean, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Some of the bystanders said, "Look, he is calling for Elijah." One of them put a sponge full of vinegar on a stick and laid it to his lips. Others said, "Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus, having uttered a loud cry, breathed his last breath. Surely, he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that made us whole. And with his stripes, we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. And now may Jesus Christ, who for our sake became obedient unto death, even death on a cross, keep you this night and strengthen you forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.